Good evening, everybody. And on behalf of the Society for the Promotion of Hellenic Studies, I'd like to welcome you to this evening's event here. I apologise on behalf of Bob Fowler, our president, who's unable to be here. My name's Margaret Mountford, and I'm our honorary secretary. So I have the pleasure of welcoming you this evening and also of welcoming our guest speaker, Paul Cartledge. Now, everybody always says about a guest speaker, he needs no introduction, but really, Paul does need no introduction. He's well known to many of you here. He's, as it says here, Emeritus Leventis Professor of Greek Culture at the University of Cambridge. What not a lot of people know, but very important to me, coming from Northern Ireland, is that his first academic position teaching was at the new University of Ulster. So beat that. Paul has written on many subjects involving and relating to ancient Greece. One might say the Spartans were perhaps his first love, but he moved on through Alexander the Great, religion, Greek political theory, and here we are today with democracy. And he has said, our democracy would look like a creeping crypto-oligarchy to the ancient Greeks, and many today may be coming to a similar conclusion. And if the closest we get nowadays to democracy is a referendum, perhaps the alternatives are more attractive. Anyway, here to talk about 10 things you ought to know about democracy in ancient Greece. Please welcome Paul Cartledge.
So first of all, can you all hear me? Because I believe there have been problems in the hall in past occasions. Anybody not hear me? At that you can't hear me? In what sense? Can you not hear me? Well, I'm afraid that it's just one of those issues, I'm afraid. And the acoustic's probably not brilliant. But when I started work on democracy, I was of the opinion, it seemed to be a generally held one, that there wasn't enough of it about. And there was a Kant phrase, a current phrase, democratic deficit. In light of the referendum in Scotland, and only in Scotland, in 2014, the general election of May 2015, and the referendum on the future of the United Kingdom within the European Union or not, in June of this year, I'm inclined to think that we are living in a time of democratic surplus. But before I go any further, I must make a few words of thanks. First, of course, to Margaret on behalf of the Hellenic Society, or Society for the Promotion of Hellenic Studies in full, with which I have been associated and proud to be associated since the 1970s, getting on, in fact, for 50 years. Secondly, thanks to the organisation thanks to which we are here, namely the Hellenic Centre, directed by Agatha Kalispera. Thank you so much to the Centre and for all you do, not just for ancient Hellenic studies, but for Hellenic studies altogether. This is one of the key centres in the world for the promotion of Hellenic studies. So it could not be more appropriate a place for someone to give a lecture on behalf of the Society for the Promotion of Hellenic Studies. So thank you to both of those institutions, but above all, thank you to you. Have you not got anything better to do on a Wednesday evening? Thank you so much for coming, and bear with me. Now, the title I've put up there, 10 Things You Ought to... Of course, there are many more than 10. That was just to get you here to see possibly what they were. Now I'm going to let you in for a little shock. I'm not going to go serially through 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm going to give you lots and lots of examples of ways in which ancient democracy, or rather democracies, because there was no such thing as ancient Greece, so there was no one ancient Greek democracy. There were lots of different sorts of democracies in lots of different ancient Greek cities. I'll come back to all this later on. But if you wish, after the lecture, if you're sufficiently engaged and not completely numbed, there will be a handout at the back which does indeed have 10 things that you should know about democracy in ancient Greece. So as you're sipping your wine, you can glance at this. As you go to bed, you can remind yourself of what the top 10 are, and then you'll be incredibly well equipped for your next party when you want to talk about what is it that makes ancient Greek democracy, democracy in ancient Greece, so on the one hand fascinating, but on the other hand so different from anything that you or I have experienced in the guise of democracy. I've been on this planet since 1947. Some of you, I'm looking around, I'm guessing, have been on the planet longer. We have experienced collectively some of the most enormous upheavals. And of course, if you were born before 1930, let's say, you will have experienced, at least indirectly, the suspension or total destruction of anything that might be called democracy by way of fascism. And if you are from the east of Europe, perhaps you believe that Soviet communism was likewise a denial of what you and I understand as democracy. But it's a fact, and it's one of those ironies, isn't it? We are all democrats now, aren't we? People's democracy, the People's Republic of China, the old Soviet Union, the old East Germany, these all have democratic or democracy somehow in their title. We claim to be a democracy, but somehow we manage to reconcile that with having a hereditary monarch and a House of Lords, which I don't think many of us voted for recently. Either of them, either the Queen or the House of Lords. You see what I mean? Democracy is a weasel word, and it is something that I'm going to try to deconstruct a bit for you, but specifically from the ancient angle. If you wish to ask me about modern democratic politics, of course I'd be delighted to have a discussion with you, but this talk will be focused principally and very much directly on versions of democracy in ancient Greece, and in particular in ancient Athens, where it originated. So the first slide, an image of my book, which you'll see at the back of the hall, and it shows on the cover a picture of the Acropolis of Athens as painted by a German painter who was a court painter, so this is under the Greece as reinvented following the overthrowing of Ottoman control through the liberation of Greece in the 1820s, late 1820s, and the great powers, as they're called, the French, the Russians, the British, in our wisdom, we decided to impose upon Greece a monarchy, and we selected a monarchy of a German sort, and in particular from Bavaria. In the center of that picture is a gentleman who will recur. This is the cover of the American version of my book. If you look at the back when you leave, you'll see a full color version, something like the original color of the painting of the 1840s. And it shows you an orator standing up with a helmet. And you might think, goodness, was it so dangerous standing up in the assembly of the Athenians that he might get, for example, a spear or a rock hurled at him? Well, I'll come back to explain why the gentleman in question is shown with a helmet. Down here is a person who could not possibly have been at any real assembly meeting on the Pnyx Hill underneath the Acropolis of Athens, because that person is feminine. It's a woman. So it's very unlikely that she would have been standing there, gawping, looking up. But on the other hand, there are, you know, a number of other sorts of characters who possibly would have been there. We think the ancient Athenian assembly could accommodate something like 6,000 people, at other times perhaps a few more. For some votes, they actually needed a quorum of 6,000. You had to have 6,000 at two assembly meetings sequentially. So 6,000, think about it. Have you been to the Royal Opera House recently, any of you? 2,000 there. You might think that's quite big. Well, that's three times as big. But of course, if you've been to Wembley, then you've got 100,000. So everything is sort of relative. This is a very large outdoor assembly, a decision-making, a decisive, in-your-face, face-to-face kind of politics. So that's the cover of my book, which it wasn't entirely my own choice. The book is entitled Democracy, a Life. So I start with its, as it were, birth, its gestation, its development, and its continuity, but very broken continuity, between antiquity and through to the early modern period, when the word starts to creep back. It dies for about 1,000 years. There's no democracy anywhere of any sort, and it's not so labelled. And I'll explain why that is right at the very end of my talk this evening. I'll talk for about 40 minutes, by the way. Please do feel free afterwards to come in, ask questions, make interventions, make comments, whatever you like. A life, but a life in interrupted, punctuated, if you like, bursts and some periods of dormancy when, as I put it in the book, democracy was on life support, only just barely ticking over. Then it comes to life again, beginning in the 17th century, and that's, of course, with the what some of us call the English Revolution, Oliver Cromwell. I come from Putney, and if you go to St. Mary's Church, Putney, the very same church where the Levellers or Putney debates were held in the 1640s, in fact, 1640s, they were all agreed, the participants, with Oliver Cromwell in the chair, the new model army, that they were anti-monarchists. They were all, in other words, republicans. What they weren't agreed on was what to replace the monarchy with. And as it happens, of course, what happened was what was called a protectorate, and Cromwell took the title Lord Protector. Lord, that's a bit suspicious. But actually in 1657, he's on the record as having considered taking the title of King. Of course, he didn't last much longer, and monarchy was restored in 1660. Cromwell's corpse was dug up and desecrated. Very unpleasant position and picture. And we haven't really in this country experienced political revolution involving thoughts of democracy such as the 1640s, 1650s, 1660s ever since. Other countries, of course, have gone through the American Revolution, the French Revolution, the various revolutions of 1840s and so on, and much more recently, terrific upheaval, the so-called Arab Spring, which very quickly turned to an Arab winter, was some sort of democratic movement. So democracy is a potentially very lively, not a comfortable thing, and that's one of the messages that I want to try to get across, and I'll try to do it in an ancient Greek sort of way, because it's etymologically uncomfortable. So, enough of the book. Demokratia is the ancient Greek term, a portmanteau word, in other words, spatchcocking together two Greek words, demos and kratos, you see on the right-hand side of your slide. Well, now, kratos is pretty much unambiguous and therefore not so value-laden or problematic. Kratos means strength, power, might, grip, and therefore, depending on who's exercising it, wielding it, you are either in favour of it or you're against it, you're exercising it or it's being exercised against you. But in itself, it's quite clear what kratos is: power, strength, might, grip. Demos is a quite different word, and this is the interesting thing about it, because it's radically, fundamentally, essentially ambiguous, and therefore ambivalent. So etymologically, the word is attested on the Linear B tablets, goes way back into the second millennium BC, where it means a village. It's a unit of habitation and perhaps taxation. It retains that meaning all the way through. Athenians in the 5th and 4th centuries BC, and before and after, lived in demoi. They lived in villages, which under their democracy acquire a new function as parishes or wards. In other words, voting districts where you become a citizen, where you register yourself as a citizen, where you perform citizen functions of a democratic kind. But I'm not interested in that relatively trivial, I mean it's not totally, but relatively trivial sense. I'm interested in the big picture, demos. Where it can mean, and now in order to get across my point about its ambiguity and ambivalence, I resort to analogy, anachronism and analogy. One sense of demos is people, and you're probably all familiar with that, the equivalent of Roman populus, all the people. Yeah, but which people exactly? Well, suppose you're Abraham Lincoln at Gettysburg, 1863, and you're harking back to the fact that in 1776, the American colonies revolted against the tyrant, George III, and revolted successfully and created a republic. Well, Lincoln refers to the form of governance that was established by the American Revolution as government of the people, by the people, for the people. So you might say, suppose a black person had been listening to that speech. And of course, Lincoln, as a Republican, was fighting the Civil War to free the South from slavery. No black person was part of that people in 1776, nor indeed for many, many years to come. So it's one of those very comforting sort of words. And so we might say, the people of the Athenians, the people of the Thebans, without specifying what bit of the population had kratos in the sense of political power, strength, grip, might. Second meaning, and here I invoke Karl Marx and his follower and successor Vladimir Ulyanov, otherwise known as Lenin. They used a phrase which was an agitational phrase. It was to get people going, and it was meant to signify a particular form of political regime that would be transitional. It wasn't a goal in itself, it was a transitional goal on the way to something even better. And the phrase was dictatorship of the proletariat. Now, proletariat's from the Latin. A proletarian is somebody who only can produce children, hasn't got enough property to be registered on the census as a property owner, but can produce children, proles, so proletariat. It's a rather demeaning term. And of course, the Romans were fiercely property conscious. Dictatorship of the proletariat is a phrase applying to the masses, the majority, the poor, the workers. So not, in other words, the elite, not the few, not the well-born, not the rich, not the clever, not the beautiful, etc., etc. Now imagine you're one of those elite. You're one of the few. You're smart, or you think you are. You're beautiful, you think you are. You've got aristocratic ancestors, etc., etc. What would you think if a term is coined in which there is kratos, the people who hold it are the demos, and demos means masses, proletarians, poor, majority, workers, peasants, not you. What's the power that they're holding? Or more particularly, for what purpose are they holding it? And against whom are they wielding it? Well, you might very well think, you. So in other words, it's even been suggested the word demokratia was invented by its enemies to constitute something, oh my goodness, we don't want that. Well, now that's only a possibility. Fact is that the word is not attested for some 70 years after something that we would want to call demokratia had come into being, and that's part of my story. On the left, and this is, I'm asking you now to travel another 150 or so years after the first attested use of democracy. We're in the 330s here. And this is a relief stele, beautifully laid out. All the columns are exactly above each other and exactly going across with precisely the same number of letters. So it's what's called stoichidon, stichidon. And here is a gentleman, naked to the waist, but he's got a nice cloak, he's bearded, he's of a certain age, so he's middle-aged, one would say, getting on towards old, so revered, respected. And on his right is a female figure, totally clothed, and she is in the act of crowning him. Well, this is Demokratia sacralized and personified, the goddess democracy. I don't think many of us would think of our democracy in such a way, if we're religious, that it's something we would want to actually pay cult to worship as something superhuman and divine. That's just to illustrate the difference between their conception and construction of Demokratia and ours. The stele is a text, and it emerges from a very, very crisis-ridden, crisis, of course, a Greek word meaning a moment of decision, choice, crisis. And because we use it in a negative sense, it's usually, you know, we're faced with a choice between two evils and things are likely to go bad. Well, in the context in which that law that it's up here, you see, proposed by this gentleman, divinely named, by the way, Eu, well, Kratos, Krates, good strength. He proposed it, and it's a law on tyranny. It's a law against tyranny. The way the Athenians conceptualized the origins of their democracy was as overthrowing a tyrant, a man called Hippias. And they, in fact, invented a myth, a comforting story of how and why tyranny was overthrown and replaced by democracy. The fact of it doesn't matter. What matters is that for the Athenians, tyranny is the antithesis, the opposite position of demokratia. So demokratia is self-empowering of the demos, in either the sense of the people as a whole, all the citizens, adult male citizens only, of course, or in the sense of the masses, the poor, the majority, who actually, when they come and vote, they constitute the majority, they vote, they are the majority. And tyranny, which is sole rule, one, it's a form of monarchy, it's non-legal, it's extra-legal, it's not a constitutional form at all, it's based on power, not on right, not on law. And so in all these ways, it's the exact opposite of demokratia. And that just illustrates to you, I think, the iconography of ancient democracy, something most Greeks didn't read very often, much. It's thought probably most Athenian citizens were, in some sense, functionally literate. They could write their name, recognize their name. But very few would have had access to texts. Putting this up on the Acropolis, or in the Agora, the gathering place, the civic center, is a public statement of what it is to be a democrat, to be a member of a democratic society. And the date, I should add, is immediately after the Athenians have lost a major, major battle, the Battle of Chaeronea, as it's pronounced today, Chaeronea in antiquity. And it's in Boeotia, it's a major battlefield, several battles fought there. This was one where the Macedonians, led by Philip and his son Alexander, defeated a mainly Athenian and Theban force and threatened Athens's democracy. So they were particularly concerned that somebody might step up and say, I think Philip is a great thing, bring it on, this democracy, terribly risky, you know, we must sign up to some form of oligarchy, we must support Philip, who is of course a monarch, and we must therefore do our politics differently. So, I mentioned Kratos in the previous slide. Some of you will know that a play attributed to Aeschylus, one of the, I don't know, 90-odd that he might have had performed in his very long lifetime, he was born about 525, died about 456, so 70-odd. just about exactly the age that Aeschylus was when he died, 69. And we only have seven of his plays, and one of them, conceivably, wasn't by him, but just was attributed to him. It seemed very Aeschylean, and that's the Prometheus Thesmotes, or the Prometheus Vinctus in Latin, the Prometheus Bound in English. And one of the characters in Aeschylus's play, in fact, the very first character to speak, who starts the whole ball rolling, the whole play off, is called Kratos. Kratos in Greek is neuter, but of course the actor would have been male. All the actors in ancient Greek drama were male, whether they're representing gods or humans, females or males, slaves, free, whatever, whatever. All the actors, all the speaking and non-speaking actors were male. And the key thing of this, why do I start with a playwright? What's that got to do with democracy? Well, I have a very strong view, not everybody holds it, that theatre, and in particular tragic theatre in Athens, was a specifically democratic form in its origins. That's to say, it's not a coincidence that the first theatre of Dionysus is built into the Acropolis, just about when Athens first becomes a democracy. It's not a coincidence that the organization of the theatrical festival, it's a religious festival in honor of Dionysus, is carried out in a completely democratic way, and so on and so on. It's not a coincidence that, how do we know which playwright's going to win? Because this is a competition. There are three tragic playwrights competing again because 10 ordinary Athenians are chosen by lot out of the crowd, and the crowd might be 17,000 compared with 6,000 plus in the assembly, 17,000 possibly at the plays. Those 10 men are going to choose the winner. A random thing, you know, no sort of elite, really theatrically smart people who've been to lots of plays and they really understand what doing a tragedy is or a satyr drama, but ordinary Athenians, because it's a political act, attending the theatre, voting on the plays, and going away and then talking about it. Well, the plot of the PV, of course it's taken from myth, ultimately goes back to Hesiod and before that, but there's this particular spin given to it to make it suitable for a democratic situation. Zeus behaves as, you've guessed it, a tyrant. Well, as soon as that's presented, you know, on the one hand, Zeus, well, we respect him. He is, after all, the father of the gods, the most powerful god. Goodness, it'd be a bit risky, wouldn't it, to get him against us, to sort of annoy him. But Aeschylus portrays him as thoroughly unpleasant. He never appears. Apparently, he never was impersonated as a god on the stage, whereas Athena is, Aphrodite is. So it's quite interesting that he was never impersonated. At any rate, he is presented as a tyrant. Well, who's going to stand up to him? Only another god could even conceive of doing so. And that's the whole plot of the play, because Prometheus is a god. He's a titan. He's of an older generation of god, the same generation as Zeus's father. And if you don't know what Zeus did to his father, see me afterwards. At any rate, Zeus acquires soul power through a civil war among the gods. And in the PV, there is several key references, one right at the end, to civil war. Now, if Aeschylus, if he did indeed write it, and if he wrote it in the early 450s, well, what had happened in Athens in the late 460s? A major political transformation involving the assassination of a leading democrat. So you see the point. This is extremely political theatre. Now, I've used lots of words already, of course, which are derived, and almost all our political vocabulary is derived from either Greek, ancient Greek, or from ancient Latin. So I could have added more, a kleptocracy you might have wanted to see up there, the rule of thieves, or ochlocracy, the rule, the power of the mob, ochlos, a crowd in a negative sense. I mean, these words are now thrown around. But let me just take you quickly through these, especially the Greek ones. Our word politics comes from ancient Greek politikon, politika, which doesn't mean political or politics. It means something to do with a particular state form, namely the polis. And people differ how to translate that. I personally go for citizen state, as opposed to some people say city state. But anyway, it's an amalgamation of a typically fairly urbanized center where decisions are made, and a periphery, which is where most people actually live. Aristotle was the great theoretician of ancient Greek politics, a pupil of Plato. We'll come back to Plato. And he wrote a work which is transcribed as Ta Politika, matters to do with the polis, not, that's to say, what you and I would say, politics. Anarchy, the an is privative, it's negativizing what follows. The archi bit means rule, so not rule, no rule, anarchy. Aristocracy, crassy, same ending as democracy. Aristo is best. How can you tell who the best are? Well, because they say they're the best. And of course, it's a matter of wealth and birth and all sorts of stuff. Monarchy, archy, we've had. Monos means soul alone, so rule of one. Tyranny, I've mentioned. Oligarchy, the archy bit. Oligoi, a few, and typically a few rich. Rich enough not to have to work, rich enough to own slaves, rich enough to think of themselves as superior to, different from the demos in the sense of the masses. That's the oligoi versus demos sense. Plutocracy, plutos is wealth, crassy, might, strength, grip, and democracy. From the Latin, citizens, I've used the term citizen state from civis, and constitution, something that's stood together. Empire from imperium, power. There is no, interestingly, Greek equivalent of imperium. The Greek for imperium, the Greek equivalent is archi, and that's quite a different sort of semantic range, because it can mean just an office of government, or just any kind of rule, not specifically imperial rule. Liberal, well, from the Greek, Latin rather, for free, so something to do with ways in which you think of yourselves as being free to rule yourself or free to rule others. Republic, interesting, like democracy, it's a portmanteau word, res and publica. Publica is the adjective for populus, populica, contracted, publica. Res means thing, so it's the people's thing. What is the thing? Well, there is a Greek equivalent, pragma, pragmata. It means the state, it means the public organs of state. And state is the next word, which means something established originally. Power from potestas, people from populus. Covers the waterfront pretty much. Moving on. I've already made the point right at the beginning that there was, in a way, no such thing as ancient Greece. There was ancient Hellas, and it's what, of course, Greeks call themselves today, from Hellas, Hellenes, Hellas, Hellenes. And there were indeed Graikoi. The Graikoi lived somewhere up in North Greece here. But the reason we call the Greeks Greeks is because of those pesky Romans. When they conquered Greece, they gave to Greece a very negative term, a very diminishing, demeaning word. And if I were talking to you, if you were in America, I would say it's a bit like calling the United States Delaware. Because Delaware is, I think, the smallest state. This is really to put the Greeks down. So the Greek world spans the Mediterranean, most of it, apart from this bit of North Africa, which is, of course, Phoenician, as indeed was Western Sicily, Sardinia, and this bit of Spain. But Greeks all round, and then after Alexander the Great, they expand way further east, as far as Afghanistan, Pakistan. And what unites them all are two things, really: language and ethnicity. In some sense, belief in common stock and the fact that more or less all of them can understand each other, even if they speak very different dialects. Secondarily, on top of those two, if you like, essential qualities, are commonality of custom, so that they all typically are monogamous. But, and this is the key point I want to make, whereas Greece today, alas, Elaba, is a kratos, modern Greek word for state, unitary state, and it's this bit here, there was no political entity, Hellas, in the ancient world. There were about 1,000 separate political entities, most of which were polis, citizen states, the two most important or famous being Sparta and Athens there. They were not both of those democracies. I'll come back to that fact, why Sparta, how Sparta was not. But the key thing is that there may have been hundreds of democracies, but not all 1,000 of them ever were or had a version of democracy. So that's another reason for not using the phrase ancient Greek democracy. We mean democracy or democracies in the ancient Greek world. So, I mentioned that I would come back to the figure in the centre of the German watercolour. 1840s, who's standing up in the assembly on the Pnyx Hill wearing a helmet. Here he is. Pericles allegedly was embarrassed by the shape of his head, and various jibes and jokes were made about it, and it is said that at any rate when he had his photograph taken, he always had a helmet on. So, and that's the point. It's this bust, actually, by Chrysilas, originally bronze. Bronze is the elite material, stone is second rate, and this is, of course, a Roman period copy of a Greek bronze original. On the other side, on the left, though really he should be on the right, is Plato. And the reason that I juxtapose these is that, for the reason I gave right at the beginning, demokratia, mass rule over the elite, shading over into mob rule, dictatorship of the proletariat. Well, if you're an intellectual, as both of these were, but if you're an intellectual who believes that smartness is the basis, the only legitimate basis of political power, then you anathematize the notion that any old Joe, any citizen, just because he's a citizen, should be entitled equally, every citizen counting for one, no one for more than one, by majority vote decide what the city of Athens or wherever is going to do and what it's going to be made up of. Plato abhorred that very notion and went to great lengths to show why democracy and the foundations of it in intellectual thought were vicious and negative and harmful and so on. On the other side, we have one of the very few intellectuals who are known to be pro-democratic in an ideological, not merely just functionally pragmatic sense. We don't, of course, I mean, of course, we have hardly any writings by anybody from the ancient world, but we don't happen to have anything that Pericles himself certainly wrote and, as it were, signed off on. But what we do have is a famous speech which was put into his mouth for Pericles to deliver within the pages, as it were, of a historical text, namely Thucydides' History of the Peloponnesian War. And so Pericles' funeral speech is a hymn to a version of demokratia. It's not one necessarily that every Athenian would have signed up to. There were different ways of which you could be a democrat, but Pericles was undoubtedly, whatever else you might think of him, a democrat. So I juxtapose those two, partly to remind us that the Western tradition of thought about democracy, from its beginnings right through to the 19th century, indeed beyond, has typically been negative. Democracy has not typically been thought of intellectually as a good thing, as represented in political theory or political thought. Now, I mentioned Thucydides. He is in this bust, the gentleman on the left here. On the right is this gentleman. This is a bust in stone. It's from Naples. You'll see it in the National Museum of Naples. And it's a Herm, and I think it beautifully captures the fact that these two men are, on the one hand, inseparable. On the other hand, they're fixedly looking in diametrically opposite directions, and they will never share a unified gaze, let alone look at each other. So Thucydides believed that politics was what it was all about, that history should be written to explain why, in particular, states behave towards each other in the way they do. What makes politicians tick? What makes states operate in the way they do? And in particular, why they fight each other and why one side or other wins. Herodotus, now you might be thinking, wasn't he also a historian of war, and indeed of a great war? Did he not actually sort of glory in the fact that he was celebrating the great and wondrous deeds of two civilizations, Persian, Greek, that were clashing, a clash of civilizations in some sort of positive way? Well, yes, all that is true. But Herodotus was not, on the one hand, a celebrant of war. He actually clearly did not like it any more than whoever Homer was, I think, probably liked the fact that humans kill each other in unpleasant ways. Herodotus also did a great deal more than just describe military action. He described social customs. He was a kind of ethnographer. And he was particularly interested in religion, for example, relations between humans and the gods, and relations between men and women. He was a pioneer gender historian. And for all these reasons, and in particular, because he privileged explanation as the ultimate task of the historian. Why did the Greeks and the Persians fight each other? Why did ultimately the Greeks win, those Greeks who agreed to resist the Persian invasion? So Herodotus is a different sort of historian. He uses the word historia, but by it he means research. We today use that term only in one context, in the original sense of research, that's natural history. Historia naturalis, history of nature, historia physios in Greek. History there means inquiry, research. Well, Herodotus is very interested in the different ways in which human beings did politics. And he selected, and to many of us this is an extraordinary choice, to instantiate his discussion of the merits and demerits of what we would call monarchy, oligarchy, and democracy in the form of a debate among three noble Persians. Well, some of you may have read this, book three of Herodotus's history. The pro-democrat speaker, interestingly, does not use the word demokratia. And I think the reason for that is that that was a controversial term. If he'd used it, the other two would have said, you mean you're advocating mob rule, are you? Demos, the masses, the unwashed, the ignorant, the stupid, the fickle. No, no, no. What he advocates is isonomia, equality under the laws. And that would be how a democrat would emphasize that democracy was on the one hand a matter of equality, so all those duly qualified as citizens, adult males, free, should be equally empowered. And secondly, they should be free. Free in two senses. Not slaves. I emphasize this is a slave-holding culture, and that affects many, many aspects of their way of thinking as well as doing. And free because they're not enslaved, to act politically, to be self-determining. So that's democracy. Now, the gentleman who spoke up in that debate for monarchy is this one here, who is standing on one of his defeated enemies and in front of a whole bunch of them linked together by a rope round their necks, with behind him his bow-bearer, his spear-bearer, and above him a symbol representing the divine authorization of Ahura Mazda, the great god of light of the Persians. For this is Darius, Darius, Dariosh in Persian, Darius in Greek, Darius in Latin. Darius the First, the re-founder of the Persian Empire. Well, he stood for, he was emblematized as the incarnation of everything that a Greek city was not. He was an autocrat. He was Persia, as in Louis the XIV, l'état. C'est moi, and no one else. He was not responsible. That's to say, no one could check him in law. He could do, say, exactly what he wanted. He was an unfettered autocrat. Now, how do I know that this is what the Greeks thought about him? Partly from Herodotus, but partly from Aeschylus, whose first surviving play, The Persians, is all about the conflict between mainly the Athenians and a son of this gentleman here, named Xerxes. And it is a hymn to what it is to be a free people, as opposed to a kind of tyranny, an autocracy, such as the Persian Empire. Now, I've talked about one aspect only so far of how the Athenians made their decision. I showed you that stele, which was the result of a vote in the assembly, passed by majority, inscribed by public authority on a very nice piece of marble, set up in a public space, all the above. But whereas we today think that politics is one thing and justice, legal justice, is another, the judicature, the legislature, the executive branches of government should all be kept separate and act as checks and balances to each other. So the theory goes back to the Americans, or back ultimately to John Locke, and instantiated in our own mixed constitution. The Athenians, like most other Greeks, thought if you're in power, if you have political power, kratos, you exercise it everywhere. So in the assembly, in holding office, in holding military command, or, and this is the point of this particular slide, when you are acting as a juror. Now, juror's a bit misleading because the Athenian jurors were also judges. Every year, there was an announcement, who wishes to put their name forward to be inscribed on the panel, if you like, of 6,000 citizens, perhaps a fifth, perhaps a sixth of the total, who might at any time be called up to serve as a jury and as judges in particular cases, whether private or public, what we would call political or non-political. I'll give you just one illustration. I've written about it in the book. I've written about it elsewhere, the trial of Socrates. Now, Socrates was tried for impiety and secondly for political misdemeanors, a kind of treachery, treason. Main charge was religious, that he did not duly recognize the gods whom the city, that is the Athenian people, the democracy, duly recognized. The issue wasn't only or so much whether he really didn't. In other words, was that factually accurate? No. The issue was, is Socrates' behavior, his spoken words, his attitudes, conducive to good relations between us, the Athenians, and the gods, or not? Is his presence, his teachings, his demeanor conducive to the gods being nice to us, or not? Well, just a few years before, Athens had lost that Peloponnesian War. Remember, I mentioned the subject of Thucydides' history. And many Athenians felt that it was a judgment, not just on their leaders, not just on the way they'd fought, but on themselves as human beings in relation to the gods. Many Athenians took it as a punishment that they had been wicked in some way, derelict in some way and therefore deserved to suffer. Well, here's Socrates, this free thinker, remember the clouds. Socrates, this teacher of Critias, not only a very unpleasant oligarch, but who'd written a play questioning whether there were any gods at all, or if there were gods, whether they promulgated justice or not. So in other words, this sort of intellectual free thinking that tipped over into not quite atheism, but at any rate some sort of dangerously loose attitude, if you like, to the conventional religion. So a juror would put his name forward and want to be chosen. Actually, 500 of them were chosen in 399. They rolled up with their token to prove who they were. This is the equivalent of an ID card. And so attached were jurors and Athenian citizens to their ID cards that some of them were actually buried with them. It mattered. It was so much part of them to have been a juror. They had a number of equipment, bits and so on, to cast their ballots, guilty, not guilty, death or not death as the penalty. And so what you're seeing here is in microcosm, an equally important aspect of being an Athenian democratic system, citizen, which is very, very alien to our way, I think, of doing democracy. I've been called up in my life only once as a juror, and for some legal technicality, the trial was interrupted and stopped. So I never actually got to cast a vote, guilty or not guilty, in a case of alleged drug dealing in the Cambridge area. So I've never quite experienced, but I was quite clear that though it was my duty as a citizen to do that, that wasn't really the essence of being a democratic citizen of the United Kingdom. Whereas an Athenian would have taken a very different view on that. So we're getting to the end. This is the last but one slide. And as I said, I'm going to illustrate to you just how different, in this as in many other respects, ancient Sparta was from ancient Athens. Well, some of you have possibly seen this inscription before. It's inscribed on this base, which originally bore a statue, which is referred to in the inscription. And the inscription up here, this is the English translation, starts off in the third person, and it starts off with a kind of thing which the Athenians had got rid of many centuries before and did not want back, kings. So this lady, Kyniska, is the daughter of a king and sister of two other kings, respectively Archidamus II, Argus II, and Agesilaus II, as it happens, all the second. Well, now, she is victorious, this is a victory statue and inscription, with a chariot of swift-footed horses, where? Olympia. She then goes on to make clear what it is that's peculiar, specific, innovative, and unprecedented about her achievement. She declares herself to be the only woman in all Hellas, there's that use of Hellas, the Greek world, to have won this, and it's an olive crown. She's not a shrinking violet. There is a bit of a discussion as to whether it was her idea to enter a four-horse chariot, which she, of course, didn't drive. She owned, but didn't drive. Or was it her brother's? Agesilaus II, her full brother. There is a source which says it was his idea, not hers. But anyway, the important point is this. The Spartans had kings, and these are full-blooded kings. They had other institutions besides the kings. They weren't just, it wasn't just a monarchy, it was actually two kings at once. And the people of Sparta did get consulted, and they did cast their votes. But whereas at Athens, each person voted individually, raised a right hand, put a pebble in a pot, and so each one counted for one, no one for more than one. In Sparta, they voted by shouting. Now, if you're a 6'6" sort of stentor, you've got a deep bass voice, you probably are going to make more noise than I, who am none of the above. And therefore, it's not egalitarian. The Spartans never got to the point of believing that every citizen was equal to every other, politically speaking. And there's another way in which, well, there are various ways in which one can point out that their mode of reaching decisions was much more aristocratic, oligarchic than it was in any sense populist or democratic. But there's a nice little story, it's an anecdote, much later, Plutarch. So he imagines a Spartan and Athenian meeting each other, and they might well have met at Olympia, actually, because they would very rarely meet otherwise. And the Athenian says to the Spartan, "Why is it that you Spartans don't do democracy like we do?" I mean, as if it's self-evident that democracy is a good thing. And the Spartan replies, "We will introduce democracy into our state when you Athenians introduce democracy into your own homes." So in other words, at home, the Athenian equal citizen in public was at home a domestic tyrant, a patriarch. They were not good, shall we say, on gender equality at Athens. Legally, they enshrined the fact that all women, all females, were inferior to all males. They indeed lacked full legal capacity, and so on. There are various ways in which the gender difference was inscribed. So the Spartans don't come out of this completely badly, the comparison between Athens and Sparta. And finally, the Athenian Democratia, or versions of Democratia in Athens, persisted for a couple of hundred years. They were then abruptly terminated by a combination of Philip and Alexander of Macedon and the Athenian upper classes, who had never liked democracy. And the word Democratia persisted, but it tended to come to mean not full-blooded people power, but not being directly ruled by a king, because the Greek world after Alexander is divided up broadly into three or four great territorial monarchies. And so if you weren't ruled by one, you could call yourself a democratia, even if actually internally the demos, in the sense of the masses, were not ruling. So in other words, democratia comes to mean republic, not monarchy. And that's the case for hundreds of years. But there persists also this original negative sense, democratia is sort of mob rule. And it's instantiated very neatly in a text belonging to the time of the reign of this gentleman, Justinian, who reigned from 527 to 565 in Constantinople. And he was presiding over, he was the top dog in a theocracy. This is a certain type of Catholic Orthodox Christianity that had been embraced by Constantine in the 4th century. He is the heir to this couple of centuries later. Well, in his reign, there was a great big riot. And it's something like a football match today. You've got extreme fans of rival chariot teams, the Blues and the Greens. And the supporters of the team that lost a particular chariot race got incensed in the 540s. And there was bloodshed. It wasn't just they shouted at each other, they actually killed each other. And a chronicler of the time, a guy called Malalas, speaks of this event, describing it, and he uses to refer to this riot the word democratia. And it's with that that I end my study of democratia in the ancient world. I then, in my book, leap forward to the Renaissance and the 17th century. But if you have been, thank you very much for listening, and there is a handout, as I say, afterwards if anybody wants to take one with them. And if anybody would like to ask me a question or make any other kind of intervention, I'm very happy to try to respond. Yeah?
May I ask you very short questions or just one?
Far away with the first one.
Okay, I'll start with the more innovative one. The first question is it in order for Western governments and for organizations like NATO to turn a blind eye, therefore acquiesce and effectively help a country whose leader and government are democratically elected but in reality they do tremendous harm to three neighboring countries, one of them being Greece, and to its own, many of its own people as well. This was my first question. And the second, which is totally irrelevant to this, is why do people know Pericles, most of them, and hardly anybody knows Clisthenes, though Clisthenes was the one who actually introduced the laws on which democracy supported. Is it because the subject of law is much more intellectually demanding, very rigorous, as opposed to politics? We can see A-level students today, I mean, if they are not that hard working or whatever, they study politics at top universities, as opposed to law, where the universities only choose the very best.
Right. Thank you very much. I mean, the first point is obviously a political point as opposed to a historical or intellectually theoretical point. And I know exactly what you're getting at, and I'm happy to discuss with you afterwards. But it's not, I think, directly relevant to what I was saying about the ancient world. Whereas your second question was absolutely spot on. And in a lecture like this, one can't go into absolutely every nuance and every detail. But I do happen to agree with you, not everybody does, that a gentleman called Clisthenes in Greek, an aristocrat, an Alcmeonid, a relative, an older relative of Pericles on his mother's side, was indeed the person who either made up, formulated, or at any rate was the decisive influence in persuading the Athenians to accept a package of reforms which later could be retrospectively labelled introducing demokratia. It's very complicated. Herodotus, my main man, actually says that, but there are colleagues of mine who beg to differ, and they think that what Cleisthenes introduced is better labelled as isonomia, which is the word that one of the speakers in Herodotus's theoretical debate uses, and that demokratia is not introduced until, you remember I mentioned an assassination in about 460, well, the guy was called Ephialtes, and it's thought that the package of reforms he and Pericles jointly introduced then introduced demokratia, properly speaking, as opposed to isonomia. Well, as I say, I'm with you, I think, on that debate. To me, Cleisthenes, it's a complicated thing, did indeed introduce demokratia. It just happened not to be so called. The first inkling that the word demokratia existed comes in the 470s, where we have an Athenian individual called Democrates. Would you call your son Democrates if the concept demokratia did not exist? Well, I don't know. The next decade, Aeschylus again, he wrote a play, and this certainly is by him, called The Suppliant Women, the Ikedides in Greek, supplices in Latin. We call it suppliant women. And he has an imaginary, it's of course imaginary, ancient, mythical scenario. The setting is Argos, it's a king, he's called Pelasgos. Somebody comes to him and asks him to make a decision. He said, look, I can't make that decision. I've got to refer you to the assembly of the Argives. And their Kratusa Chaia, their powerful hand of the demos, will decide. Well, that's as near as you can get in tragedy, which is set millennia ago, as it were, in the distant past, without being grossly anachronistic. The nearest you can get, demu kratusa chaia. Aeschylus Supplices, 463 BC, line 604. So I do agree with you, but as they say, it's complicated. Gentleman over there. Oh, someone here, sorry.
The vote concerning Socrates, do we know if it was by a majority of one, or was it unanimous? And what about the people who say that he didn't exist?
That Socrates didn't exist? I mean, is that a point you would want to make yourself, or about anybody, indeed, in the past? No, okay. Well, I mean, I think there's enough various sorts of evidence which is sufficient. Somebody surely would have said, Plato, this guy Socrates you keep writing about, you know, he never existed, did he? No. There's too much circumstantial evidence in other sources as well. But to answer your specific question, again, it's complicated. 501 votes. And a later source says that had merely 30 of the jurors voted the other way, in other words, had they voted not guilty instead of as they did in fact vote guilty, Socrates would have got off, and that's the point. 251, therefore, would have voted for him to be not guilty, 250 guilty, and he'd have got off. So take 30 away or add 30 to 250, 250, and you get, was the original vote therefore 281 guilty, 220 not guilty? I mean, that's one way of interpreting. Had 30 people changed their vote, he would have got off. But they all agree that the first vote was guilty, not guilty. Yes, he's found guilty by quite a small majority of impiety plus a form of treason. But that the vote on the next issue, okay, what's his punishment to be? Well, the prosecution said death, because that sort of a crime is so damaging that the only way we can, as it were, atone for it in the eyes of the gods and make sure this particular individual never does anything similar to what he's allegedly done before, is to kill him. Or actually, of course, hand him the hemlock, which he then administers to himself. He technically committed suicide. And so possibly the next vote was something of the order of 340 death, as against only 160 or whatever, some other punishment. Socrates did not help his own cause. Had he stood up once he'd been found guilty of impiety and said, I'm going to pay a massive fine, or possibly better, I'm going to go into permanent exile. You needn't be bothered about me ever again. What did he say? You, so far from finding me guilty and punishing me, should be honouring me as if I were a terrific benefactor of the state, the sort of equivalent of an Olympic victor. And I should have free meals in the public town hall for life. And well, that didn't go down brilliantly with those who'd voted him guilty in the first place. It didn't even go down well with quite a number of those who'd voted him not guilty in the first place. But now they thought, well, perhaps we were wrong to vote him not. This terrible man, he's got to go. Plato was his most famous pupil, Xenophon, another pupil. They were distraught by this decision, which to them incorporated all the worst features, as they saw it, of democracy. Here's an intellectual being set in judgment upon by ignoramuses. Here is prejudice as opposed to fact. Here is raving populism as opposed to intellectual, rational argument, and so on. It's one of the reasons why Plato was as determinedly anti-democratic as he was. He was probably instinctively so anyway. He was about 27 when Socrates was put to death. So he's, you know, well mature, as it were, by then. And he lived another 50 plus years. He lived into his 80s, though he never left Athens himself, except for one or two trips to Sicily and elsewhere. So though the Athenian people judged Socrates, put him to death, they didn't actually make Plato's stay in Athens intolerable. Yeah. Absolutely, yeah, yeah. Would you like to use the mic? Yeah.
Yes, thank you. To what extent do you think what Plato has written represents the Socratic ideas?
Yeah, well, I better not get very much into this because they don't all concern democracy in theory or practice. There is one dialogue where the issue of democracy is front and central. That's the Protagoras. There's another one somewhat similar, which is the Gorgias, but this is actually a rather sort of specialized question, and it's how Socrates shows that democracy is based on ignorance. It's by definition merely opinion. It can't possibly be right, whereas what he believes is based on knowledge, truth, and therefore is should be the basis of political action. But there are only a couple of dialogues in which it's actually debated whether or not ordinary people can have political knowledge. So, thank you. Over there, yeah.
Despite your initial point about the surplus of democracy, my impression is that you like or value democracy. Now, what would you say to a great classical scholar, and indeed famous for his study as a philologist of Greek thought, someone like, I have in mind the German philosopher Nietzsche, who took the opposite view. He was very vituperative about democracy, by contrast it is aristocracy. If Nietzsche was here tonight, what would you say to him?
I'd say what Aristotle said to him, that though certain individuals may be smarter than others, if you pitch a variety of different opinions into the melting pot, what you come out with is as likely to be as good as what one or a few elite individuals had come up with in any case. Secondly, the key basis of democracy is equality, whereas intellectuals such as Nietzsche, such as Plato, fundamentally disagree that all humans are in any relevant political sense usefully to be labelled equal and therefore equally empowered. If you start from that view, then you end up with oligarchy, you end up possibly with something even worse. And it's not, I think, accidental that Nietzsche's thought is in some sense believed to be, I'm not an expert on late 19th, early 20th century political philosophy, directly connected with Nazism. It's not an accidental connection. In other words, there is a genealogy there. I admire Nietzsche in all sorts of ways, but not for his views on what ordinary people can or should be empowered to do.
We see Pericles as the founder of the democratic state, yet he finished up rather unfortunately and was overwhelmed by others. What exactly happened? Did his democracy fail? Well, was there an alternative regime more powerful? What exactly was the reason for his demise?
It's a very interesting question, of course, very complicated, and we as historians must depend on the sources that we have available. And the greatest champion of Pericles in antiquity, and it was a controversial view, was Thucydides. And Thucydides makes it quite clear in various ways that he's not ideologically a radical democrat. He doesn't, in principle, think the demos, in the sense of the masses, have the wisdom to take the right decisions, with one exception. When they are led by and obey, that is, hearken to and follow the views of, such a one as Pericles. And he goes so far as to say that when Pericles was alive and his views were dominant, i.e. the masses were following his views, that Athens was a demokratia in name, that's to say it was a democracy, but what mattered about it was that it was the archy, the rule, of the first citizen. Now, that is a point of view, but it's also an ideological point of view, which, and now my questioner clearly knows, that Pericles, he actually died of the plague. He died at a time when Athens was not doing brilliantly, in a war which he, Pericles, he hadn't advocated it aggressively. He said, we have no choice but to resist the Spartans who are going to attack us. So he, in that sense, defended the war. It was his strategy that the Athenians had agreed to follow in response to the Spartans, and it wasn't going well at all. So you're quite right. He didn't die in a blaze of glory, but he didn't die despised or rejected by his people, because, this is again Thucydides, things started to go wrong. Plague hits Athens. Spartans invade and they burn the Athenians' crops in front of their eyes. Plague is exacerbated by the fact that Athenians have to crowd at the height of summer, 35, 40 degrees, into very narrow space, insanitary, poor housing, rather like a refugee camp in Lesbos today. And so Pericles gets the blame. The comic poets had for a very long time found Pericles a very good target, as it were, private eye or spitting image, and had a real go at him, especially the shape of his head, among other things. So at one point, somebody steps up and accuses Pericles of misleading the people. He is deposed from office as one of the generals. He is fined. Then the elections come round again, as they always do in the summer, and he's re-elected general. Now, Thucydides, remember, not a radical democrat, says, typical, there's the masses for you, ignorant, stupid, fickle. On the one hand, they depose him and fine him. On the other hand, they re-elect him. Well, take your view as you like. For me, this is the demos doing exactly what democracy is set up to do. If the leader gets it wrong, he should be punished. If, on the other hand, there doesn't seem to be a suitable, preferable alternative to that leader next time round, who has presumably been chastened by the experience of being deposed and fined, then you re-elect him, he's going to behave differently than when before he was not deposed and fined. So that seems to me normal democratic politics. He dies of the plague, and that's just one of those things. He happened not to be a religious man. He did not think that it was Apollo sending the plague. He thought the plague was a natural disease with identifiable symptoms and identifiable causation, etiology, epidemiology. But he doesn't end well, you're quite right. He would have been happier to have died perhaps when Athens had just defeated the Spartans, but it went the exact opposite way. In the frontier.
Yes, I wanted to ask you what place the gods have.
Wow.
And in particular the Delphic Oracle.
Okay, well, the Delphic Oracle is in Delphi, so in that sense it's not particularly attached to any one city. Sparta, for example, claimed that all its laws and its constitution had been uttered by an oracle delivered by the priestess of Delphi, or that their laws had been rationally rubber-stamped by Apollo through the Pythia and so on. So there's no necessary connection between democracy and Delphi, but there is a necessary connection between the pantheon of any democratic city and the citizens of any democratic city such as Athens. So their entire religious calendar is so organized that it corroborates, it fits in with, it's managed in accordance with the norms and nostrums of people power. Just to give you the example of the theatre again, the very first thing that the chief official of the Athenian city, when he came into office by lot, not elected, chosen by lot randomly, first thing he did was decide which playwrights should be given the permission to have their plays staged at the Festival of Dionysus, which would be about 6 to 9 months down the line, in March, April time. So they came into office in July, and then in the following year, roughly March, April, would be the plays. So I mentioned the goddess Democratia. they democratized the gods. But of course, most gods and goddesses pre-existed democracy, so they had to be treated with elaborate respect. And that was one reason why Socrates was prosecuted, whether justly or not, because he was allegedly not showing the proper respect to the gods and goddesses whom the Athenian polis, the citizens of Athens, deemed to be worthy of worship. Are we all right for time, or do you think we should start to call it a halt? I think probably. Thank you all very much.
And can I just, on your behalf, thank Paul very much. He said at the beginning, in his usual self-deprecating way, that surely we would have had something better to do. Well, I don't actually think we could have had anything better to do, and I think he's shown his complete mastery of the subject, not merely in his talk, but by answering all those different questions with such knowledge and such authority, and making the whole topic so interesting. And I very much hope that the next time we get an opportunity to vote, we'll bear all this in mind. So can I ask you, please, to give Paul a round of thanks. Thank you.